next request resource person of the day, Madam Haseem Taj, to present her views. Madam, over to you.
Yeah. A very excellent good morning to one and all, learned speakers of the day, and the principal, Professor Mallikarjunayya, and his very, very dynamic team who is organizing this program, and also the learned participant members. It is really a very nice virtual platform to meet all of you and to have a debate on a very, very apt and a very timely topic, that is NEP 2020. The topic that is assigned to me is on school education as well as the teacher education. Of course, I would like to say that this NEP is a highly ambitious document with lot of hiccups. I would like to say that definitely there are a lot of major pros, but with certain consequences also. But there are welcoming moves as far as, like, as we talk about the vision of this particular 2020, the first vision, what we call it as, that they want to, through the education system, they want to create an equitable and a vibrant society through a quality education for all. So true to that particular vision, they have overhauled and revamped the very existing pattern of education, that is 10 plus 2 plus 3 pattern, to 5+3+3=4. So definitely, like, one important step which was missing in the existing pattern of education was pre-primary education. And definitely, this is an edge that is in the new education to say that this pre-primary or early childhood care and education has definitely got the attention of the people who have voted this new education policy of 2020. Because we all know that almost 80% to 85% of the child's brain develops prior to age 6. And the child is very, very, like, most of the time we talk about the linguistic abilities of the child, the cognitive development of the child and all that. It is very essential that we stimulate the brain of the child, and we see that the child develops. And most of the students, like maybe in urban areas, wherever there is a private education, there was a preschooling and all that. But most of the government schools or public system, there is no preschooling. The child used to get start only at the age of 6, who is to be prepared for a first standard. Because the foundational skills and the foundation to education at the age of 3 or maybe prior to that is very, very important for any child. And that is being given attention, and that is being added as one of the important stages of education. So the between 3 to 5, so that is the first stage, that the first 3, and then the first standard and the second standard, where it is a joyful learning and it is a playful based activities and all that, where the child is prepared mentally, ready to be in the class for the literacy and for the numeracy, maybe for class 1. And those students who are already on the threshold of crossed 5 and they are almost at 6, for that the NCERT is going to prepare a module of 3 months, which is playway, where the child would learn for 3 months, maybe the shapes, colors, numeracy, before he enters class 1. And also, the first stage is a foundational stage, and then comes the preparatory stage of 3 years, and then comes the middle stage, and later comes the fourth stage, that is the high school stage. Whatever the existing, the intermediate or maybe the matriculation or maybe the plus 2 was there, it has been merged with the high school. But still, there is a room for an exit at 10, right? And the student can re-enter once again at maybe 11 or 12. And that option is being given. And I am just only presenting first part. Later, we'll go to the issues related to these school education and also teacher education program. Definitely, this policy also speaks about the holistic development. And of course, since time immemorial, it was the dream of any educationist, any teacher, philanthropist, or maybe psychologist or philosophers or every parent and teacher, that every child should have a holistic development. It is not that the child should develop only in only cognitive, because the present system of education wherein the assessment is made only for the cognitive performance of the child, maybe the affective, the socio-emotional, or maybe the physical, and even the psychomotor aspects are neglected. So in this policy, they have very clearly mentioned that the holistic development of the child and a holistic report card, which is 360 degree, so where there'll be a self-assessment, there'll be a peer assessment, there'll be a teacher assessment of all these aspects, where the student should learn everything. And apart from that, there is another important aspect, right from the school stage, that there is no hard separation between curricular, co-curricular, and extracurricular activities. Maybe irrespective of that, the student can have science, art, humanities, music, drama, painting, yoga, whatever that interests him, or whatever the aptitude that the child has. So the child has an option for choosing whatever he likes to have. And apart from that, multilingualism. And of course, any child between the ages of 2 to 8, he has the potential to learn as many languages as possible. So now, the National Policy of Education is very clearly saying that the education, the medium of instruction till stage 5 has to be in mother tongue, or maybe whatever the regional language or mother tongue, if they are one and the same. And if it would be good, preferably if it is still 8th standard, or if it is even beyond. Okay, so that is also from the psychological development point of view, it is evidence-based that the child can think, the child can manipulate things, and the child can have a conceptual understanding in a mother tongue better than any other language. That is a research evidence-based, and that is being given importance that till 5th standard that the medium instruction can be in mother tongue or local language, whatever it is. And from 3rd grade onwards, or maybe 3rd standard onwards, the other two languages can be added up. So the other two languages, when we are talking about, so that out of the 3 language formula that the National Policy of Education is talking about, 2 has to be the Indian languages. Indian languages in the sense, one can be mother tongue or a regional language or maybe a classical language, and the other one can be a foreign language. And the foreign language may be a English, or the even NEP speaks about, or it can also be a Korean language, Chinese language, Thai language, German, French, Spanish, whatever it is. So there can be another language that can be added up. And apart from that, see, there is as far as possible, the another important aspect that we see in the new educational policy document is that vocationalization of education, which starts right from middle school stage. By that child time, the student reaches maybe the high school, or by the age of 16 or 17 or 18, every student would have specialized in one of the vocations, or it can be many more. So minimum one of the vocations that the students have, because long time back, we had multi-purpose schools which were started on a trial basis, and the students who came out of these multi-purpose schools, which was vocational based, they could not get entry into the college because they could not compete with the general education. They had not studied the subject which were offered in a general course. And now, in order to avoid that type of a problem, now they have made maybe the vocationalization, or maybe the learning of any particular vocation, as a part of the curricular activities that should be thoroughly integrated right from the middle school throughout, maybe up to the higher education. And that is, of course, maybe a welcoming move, like the student is, apart from the other competencies, he's learning a vocation. And now, I just don't want to go much elaborate in school education. Coming to the school education, because later part I will just give maybe a little bit of the issues related to each of these, the critical analysis. When we are talking about the teacher education programs, when we are having these type of play-based, inquiry-based, discovery learning, joyful learning, experiential learning, constructivist approach, and all that, of course, they are not new in education. We have been talking about it since like every educationist is talking about this type of methods to be adopted as far as the child is concerned, as far as the learner is concerned. And where now we are talking about not teacher-centered, but the learner-centered pedagogy. So when it comes to the teacher education programs, there are three models which are offered in the new education policy. One is a four-year integrated BA, BEd or BSc BEd program. The other one is maybe the two-year BEd program. And apart from that, there is one-year BEd program. Earlier to the two, then right now we are having a two-year BEd program. Earlier to that, we had a one-year BEd program, but the one-year BEd program was abolished. Now, right now, the two-year BEd program is in vogue, and the institutions were getting ready for a four-year integrated BEd program. And actually, they wanted to maybe, it was long back when it was announced in 2000, in the beginning of 2019, February, it was said that almost all the existing teacher education programs having two-year BEd is going to be abolished. And now only the four-year integrated teacher education program is going to be in vogue. And later, the MHRD wanted to have, of course, the opinion of the states. And later, they wanted to have the stakeholders' opinion. Even in Karnataka also, the Karnataka Higher Education Council had constituted a committee to give the opinion regarding this four-year integrated program, maybe in the state of Karnataka. I was the chairman of that committee to send the report to the NCT and MHRD. There were so many issues related to that. And now also, when we are talking about whether it is school education or teacher education program, there are so many issues related to that, that these are the concerns of, on which that the new education policy is moot. So when we are talking about the early childhood care education, that particular that stage is added up, we do not have in place right now the teachers trained to handle this early childhood education, because there was no formal training under NCTE available for a pre-primary school till now. It was only now at present with the four-year integrated teacher education program, we are having two models, one for pre-primary and for primary, the other one for secondary. So that is a part of the new education policy. But till now, there were no formal teacher training programs which are aimed at preparing teachers for pre-primary. So how are we going to meet these, whatever, the early childhood care or maybe the providing access and equity and quality education to children at a foundational stage? We have the Anganwadi workers, they have spoken, they have the policy talks about the Anganwadi workers. The Anganwadi workers, of course, we all know that they are the, maybe within the area, they are the local Anganwadi workers having a qualification of 8th standard or maybe they are 10th standard, many a times without any training. And to tell you, the Anganwadi is not a part of education system, but it was part of a public health system. It was just a part of like women and child development system, that is a part of public health system. And they are not, that they were taking care of the mother and child development and providing the midday meals and taking care of maybe the nutritional and the health aspects, the regular checkups and all that, maybe very little the role they have played maybe in the education of the child. And now the new education policy is talking about the strengthening of the Anganwadis with maybe people with the 10 plus 2 with 1 year program or a diploma program or maybe a 6 months certification program. And a person with 6 months certification program or maybe with a 1 year diploma, I do not know how much justice can be done for a foundational stage, which is very, very important because it is going to be a pillar on which the whole the rest of the education system is going to be there. And apart from that, we do not have the preparedness on the part of the institutions to relocate the Anganwadis to the primary schools. And not only that, there are so many institutions still without any proper infrastructure, and the question of providing quality education maybe at a foundational stage doesn't arise until unless we have the preparedness for all these types of, when we, because there are no way that are being suggested, how are we going to make any expansion or how, what is that that we are just, we are talking about relocating Anganwadis or maybe strengthening of Anganwadis or whatever it is, and there are no proper infrastructure in place. And secondly, when we are talking about the even teacher training programs, the policy repeatedly, there are a lot of overlapping versions are there. In one place, the policy says all these standalone teacher education programs will be converted into multidisciplinary institutions by 2025. Maybe the same document speaks of converting the standalone teacher education programs by 2030. We do not know which is to be taken. And it also says the institutions which runs a 4-year integrated teacher education program can also start a 2-year in teacher BA, that is the Bachelor of Education BA program, so that the existing the bachelor's degree students can enroll into that BA program. And a 1-year BA program into multidisciplinary institutions. Those who are complete the multidisciplinary 4-year integrated program or masters in certain specialized subject can take that 1-year BA program. Those who want to enter the teaching profession. But at the same time, it says by 2030, the minimum qualification for a teacher would be only a 4-year integrated teacher education. Then what is the use of suggesting a 2-year model of BA program to be started by multidisciplinary institutions offering 4-year BA program, and then when there is the no scope for those people who come for a 2-year BA program, and also for those people who are masters and also people who have completed 4-year integrated multidisciplinary, take up 1-year BA program, and even if they are not given the teaching, that means those who want to enter as teachers, they are given 1-year teacher program. But the policy says minimum qualification is 4-year integrated. Then there is no use of having a 2-year model as well as 1-year model when the minimum qualification is 4-year BA, 4-year integrated BA. And the policy is also mute with regard to after 2020, whether this 2-year BA program is going to be continued or it is going to be abolished. Our 1-year BA program is only up to 2030, or after 2030, whether it will be continued or whether it is not going to be continued. And there are so many teacher education institutions. So one of the very, very important concern we rose that when they said all the standalone institutions will be just abolished and 4-year integrated institutions are going to be given permission to start the program. There are so many public institutions, aided, that is granting aid institutions, which are standalone. And now the policy says that these standalone institutions are transformed into multidisciplinary institutions gradually. But to tell you the fact, some of these public institutions are granting institutions, especially in cities like Bangalore, there is no provision to transform them into multidisciplinary institutions, but because of the space limitation, either vertically or even horizontally. So that is not possible. And these type of practical things have not been taken into consideration. And also the policies clearly doesn't say whether they are completely going to be transformed or whether they are, because they say gradually they are going to be abolished. And in some place they say that they are converted into multidisciplinary. So in both the cases, maybe there are places where they can be converted into multidisciplinary if the funds are made available to such institutions by the, maybe whether it is a granting aid institution or whether it is a public institution. But there are institutions which cannot be extended or expanded vertically or horizontally, and the problem remains. And apart from that, there is another important issue with regard to, now there is going to be multiple entries and multiple exists in a higher education, then it is going to become multidisciplinary. And when it comes to integrated BEd program, the integrated BEd program is already, it is been, the nomenclature itself is BSc BEd and BA BEd. So the student has to choose a science stream along with education or an arts stream along with education. And these students who are going to become school teachers, who are not given an option just to have maybe the humanities to pick up from the dance, drama, theater, painting, or maybe from yoga, or maybe from other disciplines, and where the teachers are supposed to have the knowledge of all these things, integrate it as a pedagogy for teaching these children at a lower level, maybe even up to high school, then how are these teachers are going to provide experiential learning to these type of students? So there are certain things which are not being clearly spoken about are in the new education policy, but the document looks very, very ambitious, and there are so many issues to be resolved, and there are so many challenges ahead. Until and unless these issues are resolved, and we cannot directly implement this particular policy. So maybe many more questions or any discussions relating to this, probably I would like to share maybe during the discussion. So I would like to stop the my presentation here, because there is an elaborate presentation on teacher education and school education. But our audiences, I feel that those who are here, they are mostly from the colleges background, from the higher education background, rather than from the school background. Okay. Thank you so much for giving me the opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much. In your presentation, you gave us a clarity about this new pattern of 5+3+3+4. Education is going to be integrated in the school education, and also highlighted on experiential education, and also express your concern about four-year degree program, and also Anganwadi teachers as such. And you also emphasize that policy has overlapping provisions regarding the timelines prescribed for converting a standalone institution into multidisciplinary education institutions, and also express your concern about how the school teachers are going to be equipped with this vocational education which they are supposed to impart in the coming days. I thank you for your presentation, ma'am. Now I request Professor J.R. Jagdish sir to present his views.
Thank you. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Manoj, yeah, fine. So a wonderful discussion has taken place at the instance of K. Lila College, Professor Mallikarjuna and Manoj, and is their team. At the first instance, Professor Deshpande has hammered policy makers who have not taken into account various factors into consideration for the effective making of the policy itself. Maybe even Professor Jivan Kumar has come out with this is a top-down model imposed, and the same was endorsed also by Professor Deshpande. And regarding NRF, he was of opinion that NRF is anti-federal. So these are some of the aspects that we must take into account as I am concerned with the professional education. So this has been considered to be a policy document, given their huge impact on the society and on economy. Preparation of professionals must involve an education in the ethic, importance of public purpose. For that, an education has to be education in the specific professional discipline, and lastly, education for professional practice and its role in realizing that purpose. Now, the very object is here public purpose and specialization that one should have, and for practice, how far he will be making use of that. The centrality herein is interdisciplinary thinking is required, discussion, debate, research, and innovation. That is what the motto behind this education. So ultimately, as advocated under this new policy, to be converted into disciplinary institutions. Doing is multidisciplinary or in the single campus as such. See, this was like that earlier before 1970, the private banking institutions were doing the business and they were nationalized for in the interest of public purpose. But again, by 1990 and onwards, 1994, after this GATT and GATT Final Act, see, the institutions have been privatized. And mushrooming growth of private institutions have come into existence. And now the demand of the day is public-private partnership. Now, we have reached the same stage. Earlier, universities were doing the same business. And later, we have streamlined into specialized university or standalone university or with a different nomenclature deemed to be university like that. We called the universities with the different names. Ultimately, they were doing the purpose of doing some service to the community. As regarding the professional courses, professional education, in fact, NPE has come out agriculture education, legal education, healthcare education, and technical education. Professional agriculture education. Enrollment is in agriculture university and this has to be increased. GER, grass enrollment ratio has to be increased. This is also advocated therein. And this very discipline must be improved in order to increase agriculture productivity. That is the ideology behind this. And integrating this agriculture education with general education is the expectation. So in the same manner, this design of agriculture education has to be with the idea of developing professional with the ability to understand and use local knowledge and traditional knowledge and emerging technologies while being cognizant of critical issues like land productivity, climate change, food sufficiency like this. So this is what the thematic idea behind this designing of agriculture education. So there must the institution agriculture education must benefit the local community directly. This is the expectation that local be vocal like that in the sense must benefit the local community directly. And one approach could be set up agriculture technology parks to promote technology incubation and dissemination and promote sustainable methodologies. So agriculture technology park is what the proposal made under this very agriculture education. Let's see what at the first instance these professional education is intended under national education policy and ultimately to be culminated in interdisciplinary educational institution consisting of large number of students, approximately 3000 minimum 1000 to 3000 students. That is the expectation in a multidisciplinary education institution, because the expectation there is most of the research what has been committed or conducted in the Western universities, they contributed a lot. And they, if you look back to their very existence is disciplinary institution. That idea, again, we borrowed, as Professor Deshpande has pointed out, preferred to copy it down from outside. And the same has been done even with respect to this policy making. Regarding legal education, so this is to be made more competitive globally and adopting some best practices and embracing new technologies for wider access to and timely delivery of justice. So this is the ideology therein. And we have to inform what these constitutional values of justice, either social, economic, and political, and direct towards this national reconstruction. National reconstruction through instrumentation of democracy, rule of law, and human rights. Regarding prescribing curricula for legal studies, that must reflect the socio-cultural context along with an evidence-based manner and history of legal thinking, principles of justice, and practice of jurisprudence. In fact, this is already in the legislation. They offer legal leader, offering bilingual education already there in Karnataka and other states also. With respect for preparation of future lawyers and judges in English and in the language of the state in which the institution is situated. The problem is here with respect to it is having linkage with the judiciary, which is say an integrated structure. At the top, Supreme Court, and below that high courts, and the language of these courts are in English, and the lower courts are almost conducted in the local vernacular language known to the people there. So the nothing in fact being mentioned in this very national education policy about the premier national law schools. Some 20 national law schools have come into existence by the enactment of state legislations, but they have been nomenclatured with the term national. So this is one part, and we'll come back again to the legal education, because law college is just again being given an opportunity to deal with this education. So this has to be with a program that graduates will, that has been students of all so basic standing quite different, and ultimately having specialized may have some adverse impact even on the society as such. So there shall also be much greater emphasis on this preventive care and community medicine, and this is what to be welcome. Regarding technical education, either degrees or diploma in engineering, technology, management, architecture, and pharmacy, hotel management, these are in fact which are critical to the overall development of India, and greater demand is there for well-qualified manpower of these sectors. So there is required to have such collaboration between the industry and these educational institutions imparting technical aspects. So with respect to influence of technology and human endeavors is expected to erode the difference between the technical education and other disciplines. And technical education will thus having such aim to be offered within multidisciplinary education institution and programs, and have a renewed focus on opportunities to engage deeply with other disciplines. So in fact, though it may be termed as professional as such, you know, in the recent past only some ethics being imparted, and the technology is changing, and in view of that, whether they really do any such type of specialized discipline of study, and that requires to have an integration with the humanities or liberal arts is a question. And India must also take the lead in preparing professionals with respect to the latest development in technology. For instance, this artificial intelligence, 3D machining, big data analysis, machine learning, and this may occupy the field of a teacher in the coming days. So maybe in the area of biotechnology, nanotechnology, neuroscience, this has to be made applicable to the health, environment, and sustainable living. And that will woven into undergraduate education for enhancing employability of the youth. So this is in connection with the employability of the youth that we have to integrate. That's what the advocacy made with respect to healthcare education. So regarding high quality professionals, the national education policy did dispense this very professional councils like Medical Council of India, Indian Nursing Council, and Dental Council. And there was a strong protest even by the this very Bar Council of India, which is considered to be a body established exclusively to regulate profession, advocacy profession. But unfortunately, Bar Council of India continued to regulate by means of making a rule, even by prescribing standard of legal education. So there is a conflict of interest between this Bar Council of India, which is concerned mainly with the legal profession, but unfortunately, they usurped the power of regulating the standard of legal, and they gone to such an extent of being partner with the government of Karnataka in establishing National Law School and other similar type of National Law Schools being established in 20 in number in some of the states. So there is some parallel conflict of interest between the traditional law universities, like what's in Karnataka, Karnataka State Law University, in Andhra there is a law university, in Tamil Nadu again law university, apart from National Law School I'm speaking. Whereas in Maharashtra there are two National Law Schools at Mumbai and another at Nagpur. So this is what somewhat considered to be at the state legislations. By making a state legislation, these national law schools have been established, and type of law institutions also being established in other states. The problem is NEP is advocating for bilingual policy, and whether these national institutions are in the position of incorporating this very bilingual policy for imparting legal education. And finally, this professional or general education institution must evolve into institutions offering both by 2030. This is the very expectation under the national education policy. And we have to integrate this very professional education as a multidisciplinary part. And grass enrollment ratio as on 2035 must increase to 50%. This is the expectation. So in view of that, in fact, the recent policy is other way around made. A person who is doing the regular course can also do correspondence course, so that they want to highlight this grass enrollment ratio in higher education has reached 50% as such. So in fact, some of the inadequacies have been identified by Professor Jeevan Kumar. And to overcome these inadequacies, the national education policy has been made possible. Say, for instance, nearly some 3 lakh students are going abroad for better studies in different arenas. Whether we will be in a position to cut short that, as it is really costing nearly some $10 billion. So that being the case, whether the central universities or state universities are what proposed 100 foreign universities will be invited to India, whether this will make good what we are losing in terms of economy. So this national education policy for improving education shall revolve around, is revolving around managerial bromides of greater antiquity, a great antiquity that give more money, make teachers work, train the managers of education better, ease of norms such as how many acres of campus is required. See, these things are concerned with the managerial aspect. In fact, to establish a law college, even the BCA is expecting minimum of 5 acres land in a rural urban area, in an urban area, 2 acres of land. As for commencement of medical college, MCA is expecting nearly 140 faculty members should be there to start a medical college. This is a ridiculous situation. We are supposed to have such type of how to teach. In this context, only departure from the recent past is that not expecting much research from the college teacher. See, they are dividing this university concerned with research, university concerned with teaching, and autonomous institutions having the very rank of awarding degrees. This is the 3 type of educational institutions they planned in the coming days. Here the thing is that rather ability to teach to be judged, ability to teach that has to be judged and outcome has to be assessed. So here we have to concentrate upon teach them how to teach. It is not what to teach, but how to teach. For example, in this pandemic, started technology. But office will concentrate in the home where they are supposed to receive such information, whether face-to-face interactions, whether there is dialogue in the very process. These are some of the things we are having, and maybe some unethical content may also creep in, and this is the challenge we are facing with respect to this. Now, regarding this National Research Foundation, maybe concerned with only as Professor Jeevan Kumar pointed out, it is a top-down imposition and anti-federal as such. Nothing has been stated with respect to the mechanism for Tier 2 or Tier 3 institution regarding their doing research with respect to local problem. So this is a lacuna we are having. And one more that has been pointed out by Professor Deshpande is that this term education comes under the concurrent list. Concurrent list wherein the monopoly or eroding of the importance of the state role in the immigration policy. The percentage of the GDP will be in public education. That enhanced to 2% current percent. Here from where come to the center. See, additional thing as the state, the educate is the state commission, our National Research Foundation, all these national bodies, how this state department has to manage. This is the thing of the workload is into illegal multidisciplinary education system. Yes, council legally as bar council. Is extra system. This is the very teaching at teaching law at the educational institutions, and maybe this is to ensure academic quality. With respect to curricula, already incorporated to the very legal education stream. Doing the education. The of
Manoj, I think we lost connection.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'll check.
Yeah. I think we can take rest of the views from Jagdish sir during Q&A sessions.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We could do that.
We must communicate to Jagdish sir.
Yes, yes. I'll give him a call, sir. I'll give him a call.
Sir, I think he is back, sir. He is back, sir.
Jagdish sir, you have to unmute yourself.
Yes, sir. Fine. I was telling about this very dispensing the role of Bar Council from legal education, as it is more concerned with the legal profession. And we must have some mechanism to ensure the academic quality exclusively for this law institutions. And in fact, we are following this multidisciplinary approach in legal education. It is not exclusively legal stream. Now we are concerned even with respect to not only become BLL, BSc LLB. Already IIT Kharagpur is doing this BTech LLB and only left with, and nobody has come forward to do this MBBS LLB, though curriculum is ready for doing such things. So I was advocating for this autonomy status to the law colleges which is having more than 50 years of standing. Some law colleges which are much older than the establishment of the Bar Council of India. So, identified for advanced legal studies so that they can also contribute for think tank for the advising government. And there is a necessity of establishing the Directorate of Legal Education and to have such collaboration with foreign and free access to is required. All in so that. This is some motto, some object. Ignorant law. See, if you are not knowing sir, science or English, it is an excuse. But law is not the institutions, law institutions, or other institutions take responsibility of universalizing elementary legal education. Legal literacy must be part centers. So this is what not only the lacuna we are identifying, but also I would like to place before the audience as well as resource person is how we could improve upon the legal education when we are being given a chance to remain independent apart from the policy. Regarding online education, online also being assigned to me, the use of technology. So, though I am not exposed to use of this technology effectively, but instances force go for how the data can be used. In this context, there are only learning, productivity based learning, we are advocating. That's why I made it clear earlier how to teach, that has to be taught. The teachers in the higher education effectively such type of assignment to have an experiential learning. Though internship is allowed, this experiential learning must be a motto in their teaching, and also activity based learning must be when the screen is made use. So digital platform and ICT based technology for education use has to be, this is the advocacy that has been made. Digital infrastructure has to be created, and online teaching platforms and tools, already we are having Swayam and Diksha, they must be made more user friendly as such. Students community in such circumstances. Maybe this eliminating is also required. This is what the nation and policy taking to a position for this technology. Are with this television in the home and this is after is learning. So this is again duplication of television within the home for somebody's learning. Say maybe television, radio and community radio may be used extensively, but with respect to virtual labs, this Diksha Swayam against this Swayam Prabha, so they have to be leveraged for creating virtual labs. So equal practical and on experiment based learning experience. This myth as on today, because much is publishing such type of this digital content as well as digital. They are making use of the certain senses visible for the students. So access to education maybe may have come in. Now, once this type of technology-based education, there can be this type of and examination as such, conducting examination and online. So, stereotype there may be a type of question to ask, has to be worked out as and this, whether there can be a type of blending the models of learning. See, this is one such online model and direct teaching. There are other methods of learning the things. What I said, experiential learning, or else maybe other types of learning. So this is blended.
Jagdish sir,
yes sir.
Jagdish sir,
tell me sir.
We are really unable to hear the voice continuously. Actually, we are really deprived of a lot of good things you spoke about. Many of us are not able to hear. Can we do one thing? Can we come back with the question? And in the meantime, can you, if possible, can you try to get connected to something, you know, some good bandwidth connection, so that in the question answer session it would be very useful. Very sorry, a lot of it went unheard. And I think we cannot test the patience of viewers as well.
This is another way of what we say, the drawbacks of the technology. We are situated far from Bangalore, and maybe absolutely, that is one thing, and maybe net access is also not continuous.
Proving that the drawback lies in the policy as well. It strongly contemplates of online education. So is that fine? Shall we come back with answers and you kindly if possible kindly get connected
Yes sir, thank you Professor Jagdish sir for highlighting on professional education, especially agri education, legal education, and also you emphasized on how AI and other technologies have to be integrated in the education system. Also, you are very strongly condemning BCI regulation of a legal education, and also spoke about leveraging up online platform for digital learning. Thank you very much, sir, for sharing your views on this. Now, I request our principal, Dr. J. Mallikarjunaya, sir, to take over and conduct a panel discussion. Sir, over to you.
Well, thank you, Manoj. Respected panelists and most distinguished viewers, it's almost 126 minutes ever since we started the program. Few things really become demystified out of the speaker's presentations. One, though it's a very pious attempt to come up with NEP, it looks like it's a very wishful list. A lot of things have to be worked out under this wishful list, and we have to make this wishful list to work. And second is, you know, when it only shows the time we have spent, shows we are journeying into the ocean. What we are covering is only the tip of the iceberg, is what we get to know. And the third and important thing that gets demystified to me is this, that it's over 126 minutes, and I have been seeing the participation in the group wavers between 326 to 340. It has never fallen down. It only shows how important is the subject and how interested are the people in understanding these things. Well, with this panelists, respected panelists, it was my idea to come up with four questions to each of you, and then try to take counters or different observation by other panelists. Maybe for paucity of time, it may not be possible. I'll confine myself to asking one question each panelist, and we may quickly do that. And there are a lot of questions that are pouring in the chat box, which Manoj Kumar is trying to consolidate, and he will come up after this panel discussion is over. And with this, I come to Professor Deshpande, as usual, for the first question. And sir, before I could ask a question to you, it's my responsibility to answer the legal concern that you have raised. Being in local agent, since you have raised this legal question, which Jagdish sir, in fact, delineated, because most of us couldn't hear what he said, the benefit did not go. I will make an attempt to answer this concern. And my answer, the question was, Professor Deshpande sir was talking about, since the subject falls under concurrent list, that is education, how could the center take call without taking consent or concurrence or even consultation with the states? Is that the appropriate thing to do? Would that stand the judicial scrutiny? Is it the case for judicial scrutiny? Was the question that was posed, I believe. Sir, I agree with you. We want a very different type of quasi federation where the center is awful. Okay. Sir, I was saying we work in a very peculiar federation where the center is not all powerful, nor the states are weak. There is no. Yes, there is no delegation of power, there is only distribution of power. That being the case, I agree with you, it stands the consideration of the judiciary, and legal scrutiny of the matter has to happen, I believe. I think with this response, sir, I come to the question. There are in fact a lot of questions that I had to ask to you. Anyway, I'm not going to ask about the regulatory framework. You are not only critical of the regulatory framework, in fact you did throw a lot of light on this. And before I ask this question, I would like to tell to the viewers and all on the platform that it's only the time when scholars disagree the scholarship progresses, and we all started to disagree. It only shows our commitment to live with the new education policy. From the KLE Society Law College floor today, the commitment to implement the new education policy starts with having a critical look at the policy, and that is what we have done today. Well, sir, for setting the right tone of critical appraisal of the policy as a beginning speaker, I thank for that, sir. And the question is this. Sir, there are a lot of questions. Only one I would be picking. In this policy, it is suggested that the education is going to be imparted by the government, by the private, and it's going to be not for profit. I have different views on this. Not for profit is not actually gratuitous. It's not charitable. It's not philanthropy. Not for profit, in a way, is to make it a business, at least to break even point, is what I think so. There's also an argument that why school shall not be for profit. There's an advantage of making schools for profit because a lot of investment can come into the education, etc. Sir, your take on this point, sir. You want the education to be not for profit, charitable, for profit. And what this policy speak about and your views on this, sir.
Now I am audible, right?
You are, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. I think the new education policy dealt with quite a few things. Rather, inherently and indirectly, they are urban-oriented new education policy. Urban-oriented.
Okay.
Below 3 years or at 3 to 5, no rural student would like to, no rural child would like to go to the school or even Anganwadi unless there is a food available there and they go for food. They don't go. Even in Nagar Bhavi, the Anganwadi is there and I go often from the Anganwadi. Anganwadi is my old school. I go through that. Children do come. Children who come to Anganwadi, they eat and they go and play mud on the road because playing mud on the road is their pursuit. Unfortunately, the new education policy focused more on the urban education and rather neglected the needs of public education, creating a plethora of institutions. I again recounted them. There are 19, not 15. 19 institutions in addition to what are existing. What is this? What are we doing with? There is another thing, that the same question of jurisdiction of making policy came up in 1999 when Government of India made an agricultural policy. It came in 1997 also. Agriculture policy. Then all the state governments, and in fact, I wrote the speech of S.M. Krishna, that why are you making policy for a subject which is state subject? You are not supposed to direct us what we should do in our states. And that is where first problem comes in. Second problem comes in which is I am very strong on this. The word pedagogy is used 80 times in this document. The word comes from Macaulay. It comes from 1623. Initial education in the Western world. Pedagogy is to teach a child how to behave. And from there onwards, it creeped in India. Remember, Indian ethos, what is the new economic, new education policy says, is with andragogy, Gurukul system, that I learn. A carpenter's son learns carpentry not in the classroom, but when father is doing it. A mason's son learns the construction when the father is doing it. A blacksmith's son or daughter learns it. Mother teaches. Does she take a blackboard and a chalk piece to teach cooking to a daughter? No. This is called andragogy. In fact, the entire economic education policy should have been focused on andragogy and heuragogy. The second thing is, I think like Professor Jeevan Kumar made a presentation, a very masterly presentation on multidisciplinarity. Remember, there are two concepts, multidisciplinarity and interdisciplinarity. Right on today, every university is multidisciplinary, where there are disciplines existing, but then they are in silos. They do talk to each other, but they talk only about the scales, pay scales, increments, leaves, service rules, etc. They don't talk about subjects. It is possible to talk about subjects, but then what is needed is not multidisciplinarity. Multidisciplinarity as defined in the entire course of education is discipline borrowing from other discipline. Interdisciplinarity is discipline understanding a concept from the point of view of other discipline. And that is where the question comes in. I give an example. A student of mine who worked with you, Anita, she worked as a teacher of economics. When Anita was preparing her thesis, she was preparing on in political science. And her thesis was on efficiency of bureaucracy. And she has used the tools of social anthropology and psychology. Now, this is called interdisciplinarity. And this is what is essential, not multidisciplinarity. Unfortunately, the entire new education policy went wrong on that. Third thing, which one has to learn and one must understand, and they have not understood it. The process of learning and process of knowledge assimilation, each one of you will endorse about it. First is the assimilation phase. Who is my mother? Is the one who feeds me my mother, or is the one who picks me is the my mother? That's assimilation. The second phase is understanding and coping. How do I get down the cradle? How do I pick my milk bottle? That is the second understanding and coping, which goes into the school. Systematizing the process of learning through peer in the sense that if we learn the styles, when we go abroad and come back, we start twisting the tongue. Oh, I want to say, this is peer learning. This peer learning is something which comes in the third stage. And fourth stage is top down. Top down is the approach which we follow. Give the syllabus, give the books, ask them to follow the syllabus and the books, repeat what I say and what is said in the books. If you are the best plagiarist, I'm using the word, plagiarist. If you are the best plagiarist, you get 99%. If you are original thinker, you get somewhere around 50-52%. So original thinking is killed by the process of our learning, top-down approach, syllabi and syllabus completing approach. The next phase is knowledge and the market. We learn something. The doctors learn something. We learn something, but we learn to practice it. You have learned law. Law is learned in the books, but then the real law is how to interpret what is written there. And therefore, the courts exist. Otherwise, courts would, if the law was final letter, courts would not have been there. There is no different interpretation of a particular murder. It's a murder, it's a murder. So it should be hanged. There is no defense of it. Law comes because of the interpretation. And this interpretation is the one which very clearly comes in the Ram Mandir case. Every aspect was interpreted. Even today it goes on. The last one is commodification. And there exactly we are now. We have commodified the education system. New education policy is totally absent on that. What, sir, you have said. That between market, between the philanthropy, charging for education, and the state-run education. State-run education must give a tough competition in infrastructure, in learning resources, in teaching resources, and in brilliance to the non-state institutions. Only then, both will develop. Otherwise, one will develop. In Nagarbhavi, we have a government school. The poorest of the poor come to my school. That's my school. I call it my school. Poorest of the poor come to my school. First to seventh standard. But my maid servant's child goes to what is called Oxford School in Nagarbhavi, which has a college also. There is a Clinton School. There is a Rockford School. Names are itself wonderful. Now, this is something which is commodification of knowledge. This has not been dealt with. What you have said is very correct. Between charging, philanthropy, and state. state-owned institution. Unfortunately, the new education policy tries to become more market-friendly, give autonomy to every college, and I know what autonomy means. I give you, and I'm mentioning the name. I was on the committee for Tilak Maharashtra Vidyapeeth, Pune. This is a deemed university. I was to evaluate it. The executive committee met me. Since I'm Marathi speaking, I went out talking to them even outside the meeting. I came to know that the chancellor is Tilak's grandson. The members are daughter-in-law, son-in-law, daughter, son-in, the daughter's father-in-law, daughters, and everything is family there. Then I found out that the Vidyapeeth, which was formed in 1920 by Mahatma Gandhi, the TMV, Tilak Maharashtra Vidyapeeth, has purchased 20 acres land in Matheran. What is the purpose? No, we would like to have a hotel which will train our students there. My goodness. I mean, this is an institution which was started with all ideals. We are killing them. Our march towards autonomy is that. And march towards autonomy means march towards dirtying the education system. Regulation should be there. And I feel that some of the regulatory authorities which are working today, maybe at lower level, but are still, UGC is still a powerful body. UGC still is controlling. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for those responses. I understand you oppose commodification of education. That means education for profit is ruled out. Education for charity and philanthropy is maybe not workable. Education for, not for profit with utmost regulation and by...
I would rather correct you.
Yes, yes.
No, education for... There is in economics, sorry for getting into economics. There is something called normal profit as a concept in economics.
Okay.
There is usurpian, usurious profit is another concept in economics.
Okay.
Usurious profit in the sense that I give you 500 rupees and I charge you 30% interest or 18% interest. That is usurious. But if I charge you exactly the opportunity cost of money, then it is not profit. So profit is, and in fact, in Islamist banking, profit is allowed, but not usurious profit. What I say is usurious profit. Where is it written in law? Anywhere in the educational institutional system that the moment somebody becomes vice chancellor must wear a suit. Where is it written? The moment somebody gets into a management school must have a blazer and a tie and a suit. Where is it written? Why is it coming? Some people can't afford it. But still they have to borrow. This happened in Ambedkar School of Economics, where I had the very strong objection. Why? There was a girl by name Vidya. She was not able to afford a suit. Her father was a small farmer. The problem is that we impose certain taxes or certain payments on the children. These are usurious. I say usurious should not be there. Normal profit to develop the institution for the development fund must be there.
Okay. So that may be balanced by giving competition from the public institutions.
Yeah.
That's the point I take, sir.
Exactly, exactly.
Thank you. Thank you for that clarification. And I'm sorry, we'll be coming back to you again with the viewers' questions. And I move on to Professor Jeevan Kumar, sir, with one quick question. Sir, again, I had about four questions. I pick only one now for paucity of time. Since you dealt with, I'm sorry, I stand corrected, and I'd prefer to use interdisciplinary as against multidisciplinary as, Deshpande sir tried to throw some light on that. So if it is interdisciplinary studies that is paid much attention to in the new economic policy, are the precautions taken to balance between holistic education and specialization? As we see, sir, a specialist knows more and more about less and less things, and it's not a bad thing. He needs to know more and more about though less and less things. Of course, that specialist may turn out to be bad if he doesn't know a few other things. So having holistic idea and general information about everything is very important, I understand. But if we go to draw a shift from specialization to holistic approach or only interdisciplinary approach, whether specialization suffer is my question, sir. Jayan Kumar, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Mallikarjun. Professor Deshpande actually drew our attention to a big distinction we need to be clear about. The terminology that you also referred to, there is something called multidisciplinarity. And in the context of education, the NEP speaks of multidisciplinary education. That concept is different from interdisciplinarity, where interdisciplinarity, as Dr. Deshpande told us, is quite different. Let's be clear about this distinction and let me put it on the table once again for the clarity of all of us. The NEP, to the best of my knowledge, is not talking of interdisciplinarity, it is talking of multidisciplinarity. And their understanding of multidisciplinarity is quite in keeping with the dictionary explanation for multidisciplinarity. And as I went into it in a fair amount of detail, they think that the existing education system has been completely compartmentalized. The very concept of discipline itself has put us into, has drawn compartments. We have confined ourselves to our respective disciplinary boundaries. And therefore, we are not even in communication with the others. And this is what the existing education system has done, which the NEP has taken up very specifically and said this is not the way in which one should develop a holistic individual, a balanced individual. We have to redo the entire process. And therefore, for the 21st century requirements, we have to come out of our unidisciplinary focus. We have to look at multidisciplinarity. That's what the NEP is talking about. Dr. Deshpande very rightly is asking the NEP a very pertinent question. Are you experts familiar with the distinction between what term that you've used, which is multidisciplinarity, and another term, which we also should be, as educationists, be aware of, which is interdisciplinarity? I think NEP is quite clear. They believe that if we come out of this unidisciplinary focus right from school itself and ensure that students of arts study a lot of other subjects which we have, which the document speaks about, including the kalas and all that, going back to the ancient Nalanda and other systems that we have followed. This is the way in which we developed holistic individuals at that point of time. Perhaps we need to go back to that. And therefore, let us do a mishmash, which they call multidisciplinarity, ensure that students are exposed to a wide variety of disciplines, particularly make sure that liberal arts education is brought into the curriculum and that students of science are exposed to liberal arts, students of liberal arts are exposed to science subjects. Make sure that they study all of this while they are doing their education. And then at the end of the day, when they come to colleges, ensure that you have these kinds of colleges. When they have completed the education, you will have a well-balanced, holistic, complete individual. Now, that kind of logic cannot be acceptable for some of us. Professor Deshpande also raised object to that. What we actually require, and the solution is not what the NEP has spoken about, the solution is different. The solution we find in interdisciplinarity, where you study what you want to study, don't force other subjects on the throats of unwilling students. If they want to, that's fine. Give them options. But if they don't want to, that's fine. What you need to do is what interdisciplinarity speaks about. Can we look at one discipline, one subject, one research area from the perspective of different disciplines? Can we look at a particular topic from the perspective of law? Can we look at a particular an economic subject from the perspective of political science? Can we look at a subject in economics from the perspective of sociology? When you're doing this, you are ensuring that the student is grounded in a particular area, solid grounding, but you're also ensuring while he's being, he or she is being educated, that student has the ability to look at any particular issue, a given issue on the table from different perspectives. That is interdisciplinarity. I would have loved it, and I'm sure Dr. Deshpande would also agree with me, Dr. Mallikarjuna, you'll also agree with me, that had the NDP looked at this concept, not multidisciplinarity where they bring in all kinds of things and forcing it down unwilling throats. Now, yeah, they looked at a different concept altogether called interdisciplinarity. I think this would have made many of us happy, and I'm sure this would also have gone down well with the requirements of the day. Does this answer the question that you've raised, Dr. Mallikarjuna?
Yes, sir, indeed. A follow-up question is, would specialization suffer as a result?
The way NEP is looking at it, it definitely would suffer, because end of the day, you have jack of all trades, master of none. You're forcing him to study a variety of subjects. I'm not very sure whether the foundation each of subjects has got. End of the day, his credits would be there, mark sheet would be there, which would show he studied all of those things. But if this person is subject to a quick interview by the employment agency, they would say, but tell us, what is it you're specialized in? Tell us, what is it that we need to assess you upon? And I'm sure, as the proverb says, the new NEP will be producing jacks and jills of all trades, but really masters of none. And therefore, I still believe that universities, colleges like yours, which are doing specialized, that should continue. And I think in your college, I'm sure, with the, you know, our student Chaitra Prasad is there. We had Anita there earlier from economics and so on. So if you are able to ensure that your curriculum has a good balance of other subjects which are needed for a good law student to grapple with, to understand, to get a holistic picture, I think that is good enough. The NEP does not think so, and therefore we have a huge problem before our hands. If they're going to implement their time frame, short term, long term, and so on, by 2030 something should happen, by 2040 something else should happen. Now, if this is implemented seriously, I'm afraid in the space of the next 2-3 decades, we will be in a deep mess, where we will not be producing the kind of individual that the NEP thinks it will be producing.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you so much for that candid response to the question, indeed. And I thank both professors for sowing the new seed in the young minds to distinguish between the multidisciplinarity and interdisciplinarity, and try to appreciate this vision document in that understanding. Thank you. Thank you so much, sirs. And let me now move on to Madam. Yeah, sir, Deshpande, sir, you have a response to make.
Nothing. I endorse whatever Professor Jeevan Kumar has said.
Okay.
Multidisciplinarity, I'm reading from here. Multidisciplinarity refers to addition of the competencies from the other disciplines. Like in the graduate level, we have physics, chemistry, mathematics, English, Hindi, Sanskrit, etc. So the competencies are added, whereas interdisciplinarity denotes that the various disciplines are coordinated, okay, are coordinated towards a common and coherent approach, in the sense that tools of a discipline are used in another. That is where the vision of the new education policy goes, that we have to transform India to Bharat. But while transforming, they take everything from Macaulay, everything from the British system. Interdisciplinarity is not considered. Professor Jeevan Kumar referred to Takshila, Nalanda. The disciplines are not silos. They are free. And a student learns from each other. That is interdisciplinarity. Whereas what new education policy emphasizes, that you be in your cordon, you be in your silos, you be in your silos, look out, that's all. Look out is not the one which is Bharat. Bharat is, and I give you my example. My graduation is physics honors. I went to army. I know all firearms. After coming back, I learned econometrics, which is a mathematical subject. Then I taught computer programming for about 10 years. After teaching computer programming, I got into development economics, then agricultural economics. And because I tired, I stayed in agricultural economics, but I worked in sociology. Professor Jeevan Kumar knows that the first seminal paper on economics of caste, which I and Thorath, we co-authored. There was no economics of caste before that. Sociologists were prohibiting economists to get into. When I guided the student from political science, Professor Jeevan Kumar was one of the referees in the seminar hall. I know very well how it was difficult for me to defend tooth and nail my student using different methodologies. The thing is that NEP, none of them are competent to call, none of the members are competent to call it as interdisciplinarity, because all of them, all eight members, grew in single discipline. They have no, I have seen their biodata. They have no exposure to other disciplines. They have grown in unidisciplinary manner, and therefore their unidisciplinarity is reflected in the new education policy. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for that education.
Bit more critical. Bit more critical.
Yes. Thank you so much. And I really think we haven't missed our student days in Institute of Socioeconomic Change. And we are really, happy to learn these lessons from this floor. I think with that, let me move on to Madam Haseen Taj. Madam Haseen Taj. Yes, ma'am. I believe you play a very key role in implementation of this new policy, because the new policy is going to see the light of the day. Maybe to start with, and again, I had a lot of questions to be asked. Again, for paucity of time, one important question that I'm picking, ma'am.
Yeah, please, sir.
And the question is this, a lot of news, this aspect that is creating, namely home language, regional language, local language. It is universally believed that the child learns and learns well in the language that is mother tongue.
But sir, you are not audible completely.
Technical team, there is some noise. Ma'am, can you hear me now?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
The context is this. This policy, I think appropriately, lays emphasis on learning in local language. Yes. Local language, mother tongue, etc. I think that makes sense. But my only question is, all these days, the learning in common language, that is in English, has happened for a variety of reasons. Because especially in a country like India, there are multiple languages and there is a lot of migration happening, especially in urban cities. People speaking about 10 to 12 languages would be there in one school, and English somehow, rightly or wrongly, has accepted to be the medium. Is it a viable thing? Is it practically possible for the schools to teach children in the language of their home? Is the question.
Yes. You have rightly put it, sir. As the new education policy says, the medium of instruction should be mother tongue or local language till fifth standard, mandatorily, or if possible, till eighth and beyond. So is it applicable? The policy is mute with regard to whether it is applicable only to the public institutions or including the private institutions. So nowhere it is made clear. So until and unless there is a blanket implementation, irrespective of public, private, international, whatever is the type of institution, otherwise only some socially disadvantaged, socio-economically disadvantaged children already who are marginalized, they are going to be further marginalized if this is going to be applied only for the public institutions. Because I don't think that any institution which is international or maybe some of the very reputed private institutions would probably go back and take this new education policy and start the medium of instruction and like till fifth standard only in the mother tongue or maybe in the local language. As we all know that definitely there is an evidence that the children learn better, that the thinking is in the mother tongue. But since the child's mind is so good that they can learn multiple languages, they have that competence to pick up any language even at an early age. That is the reason that even in English medium schools that the children are doing well. That is the reason even when the DSERT asked for in the public schools that the English has to be started as a subject right from first standard, so that the children who are socioeconomically disadvantaged, they should not be further marginalized because of the want of language of communication. So, and here the new education policy, when it is speaking of this mother tongue up to fifth standard, and it has not made it clear whether the implementation is applicable to all types of institutions or whether it is going to be only to public institutions. If it is for all types of institutions, like all children will get benefited because the mother tongue or whatever the local language, that's fine. Otherwise, in the private institutions or maybe in the children who are socioeconomically better off, and if they can get the education in an English medium and only in a public institution, children coming from a downtrodden, and if only those children are asked to study in their mother tongue or in local language, I don't think that there can be this divide, the gap would widen further. So this should not happen. There has to be a blanket implementation approach. If at all, if you are trying to make the medium of instruction up to fifth standard, whether it is local language or whether it is medium of instruction, it has to be common for all types of institutions.
Yes, ma'am. Hello. Yes, ma'am. I think for a second your video was frozen. Okay. Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Thanks for that response. I understand. My own belief is that whatever policy regarding language is spoken, it is spoken to be applied all across and all types of institutions. And we have to, I think, wait and see how this is going to be addressed. Ma'am, I just have the next important question to you, ma'am.
Fine, sir.
As a teacher educator, since you are a teacher educator, what are the challenges you see for the present teachers, and what adjustments that needs to be made in teacher education curriculum to incorporate this new policy?
With regard to the new education policy, as far as the curriculum or the pedagogy which is being, whatever is being suggested, I don't think that there is anything very new to it. So only that it is only the updating of the curriculum that is required. But there is a need for, in teacher education programs, they are talking about the teacher training, where the teachers become competent enough to manage children who are gifted, children who are like having special needs, children who are maybe partially, especially with regard to the digital technology and all that, they are talking about the Divyang children, that the children who are blind. And teachers need to learn the technology apart from handling these type of children who are having the special needs. In our regular teacher training program, we do not have any such specializations where the teachers are getting any adequate training. There are institutions which are handling, or which are like, for, they are coming under RCI. So they are preparing the teachers for children who are having special needs. But it should become a part of regular teacher training programs, where there has to be a specialization, where the general, the common teacher education program has to offer. Almost all the regular teachers should know, whenever there is a classroom, we have children who are gifted, we have children who are slow learners, we have children who are normal learners. And we should also know, like, in, and we are talking about an inclusive education. When we are talking about inclusive education, children coming from different cultures, children coming from multiple disability, children coming from different socioeconomic background, children coming from different religions, even handling these children is also very, very important. Apart from handling the children with disability. So our teacher education institutions need to reorient, maybe in practice, in developing the skills, in developing the competence among the pre-service students, or maybe in the pre-service or prospective teachers, in order to handle all these types of children. So the training programs, once again, not just in the pedagogy. Pedagogy is almost like whatever they are talking about, the constructive approach, they are talking about the playway method and all that, that every teacher education institution program is talking about. But handling the different types of children coming is not the part of the regular teacher training program. So we need to reorient, we need to readjust, we need to once again see that we need. So teacher education institutions, like especially one of the regulatory bodies like NCT, need to collaborate with institutions like RCE, right? Need to have, once again, some of the programs devised, and there should be a part of the programs, even in the under the NCT, norms have to be given, and the teachers, regular teachers, should also be given the different specializations where they will be. That means all teachers should be given a training or develop the skills or competence that they can handle these children. Apart from that, there has to be a specialization where certain children, teachers can become special teachers, where in the schools, like a counselor, a special teacher has to be there as a part of a school, school along with the regular teacher. So in from that perspective, that the teacher education programs need to readjust and once again reorient the teacher training programs, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Thanks for that response. I really understand teacher education, and even the teachers have to be trained. So Deshpande sir has a
I would request Professor Haseen Taj, because she is one of those strong educationists and a revolutionary one. So it is time we have to throw the word pedagogy and use it only for the primary school children, because pedagogy, it
is originated for adults. It is the word andragogy. Yes,
it is essential that these adults who have framed the new education policy use the word andragogy, because that is what they mean.
Yes,
and that is what was followed in Takshila. That was what was followed in Indian and even in madrasa.
Yes,
Indian education system, it's andragogy which is followed. I need to follow my senior how he does it, and from there onwards I learn. In fact, these people are absolutely uneducated, pedagogic. The those who framed the new education policy are pedagogic. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Actually, in the context of primary school, or maybe the middle school, or maybe to lower secondary schools, that the word pedagogy is used. When it comes to higher education, when we are dealing with the adult learners, it is the andragogy that we are talking about. And that needs to be actually, in, even in teacher training programs, when we are talking about BA, actually we have to use the word that the andragogy rather than pedagogy. So since the teachers who are getting trained to go to the school, and there they are using the word dealing with the primary school children, or maybe the middle school children, or maybe the secondary school children, in that context, that the word pedagogy is being used, not thank for you. Teaching the pre-service teachers. Thank you.
Thank you, Deshpande sir. Again, another piece of learning for the day for teachers. So we also often wrongly use the word pedagogy. Thanks for that. And again, now may I quickly move on to Dr. Jagdish. Dr. Jagdish, can you hear me? Yes, you need to unmute, sir. You need to unmute. Can you hear me, sir? You can unmute, sir. Okay.
Tanmay, you could unmute Jagdish, sir.
Tanmay, Jagdish.
Okay.
Sir. Hear me, sir. Jagdish, sir, can you hear me? I think I'm able to, my voice is able to reach you, and we are not able to hear. Since we did not hear. Sir. You can speak, we'll figure out if we can hear you. Video is also
the problem is the internet connection is not stable.
I know. Okay. Okay. I'll try and make an attempt to reach you, sir. You know, this new economic policy, I believe, has come as a great disappointment to you. Correct me if I am wrong. I also share the same feeling because for single reason, we feel disappointed. That is, BCIE is not kept out of legal education regulation. I believe you agree with me and you may be disappointed with that. Anyhow, the question I wanted to ask to you is this. Do you find any reason why legal education is kept out? And are there any lessons that are to be taken from new education policy in having a relook at legal education? Is it a case of not relooking at legal education now? Are my questions, sir, if you can hear and respond. ಇದಷ್ಟೇ ಕೇಳ್ತು
ಕೇಳ್ತಾರೆ. Most of the bar council members are non-professional advocates and exclusively meant to be there to get elevated to the bench or like that. And in that sense, the them only to begin. That being the case, they are supposed not education. Is very they are cut this very advocate revelation born by the university college again they can more entrance test taking the advocacy as profession commercial this very is made and they do totally an usurpation of the power by the Bar Council of India, which is not at all concerned with legal education. This is by the members of the consultation policy. This all the help of UGC 2010 as I said earlier, this B is also possible. B is already on BS to take it shape. We are doing LLB and DLLB. Try to...
Jayadish, try to put off your camera speak. I think we lost. Sorry, Jagdish, we lost completely.
Sir, it's a poor bandwidth, sir.
I don't know whether putting
it's
off
a poor bandwidth. It's a poor bandwidth. Therefore, it is not catching the thing. And there are fluctuations in connections also. Connectivity is fluctuating.
Correct. Jagdish, we will move on to question answers. Then question answer sessions quickly. I hope hear me. Jagdish, we'll move on to the next question answer session. We'll go to question answer session.
Yes, sir.
It's really fluctuating. Well, I think it's time. I will show the screen. Manoj, quickly. department is.
Yes, sir. Tanmay, you could mute all other participants.
Yes, go ahead.
Yes, that was a wonderful panel discussion. Most of the questions which have been posed by the participants are answered in the panel discussion itself. But however, in one or two questions from the participants, I would like to pose it to all the panelists in general. See, one of the questions asked by the participants is that whether this entry of the foreign universities, which is proposed by this new education policy, is going to affect the Indian universities as such. A general question to all the panelists. Yes, sir.
This is where I said that Karni Ek or Karni Ek, the vision of the policy, they have very clearly stated. Vision of the policy is bringing India to Bharat, and the technology of the policy is taking Bharat to abroad. It's very simple that you open an English medium school in by the side of a government school, keep the fees lower, all the children from the government school go to the English medium school. Same thing will happen. A large number of students who try to take degree from a foreign university, because everything that is imported, and they say that one politician went to the hospital, then the doctor said, sir, this will have to be given local anesthesia. Hey, local ki kal yenu kodbeda, imported kodbeko. Our mindset is that. Anything that is beyond my country is intelligent. You see anywhere, even in the workshops and conferences, I see that a white-skinned person comes without knowledge is highly respected, as against a tan-skinned person or dark-skinned person who is most intelligent. This was confronted by the leather scientist. I forgot. He died in a plane accident from Toronto to India. He was world famous leather scientist. He was dark. He was a Tamilian. He was dark. Nayundamma or something his name was. He confronted this anywhere he went because of his color, because of his Indian origin. And I know it very well. The other day I interviewed a professor at Mumbai University with a foreign degree. He said he was appearing for monetary economics. I asked him, who frames the monetary policy? He says, finance ministry. I said, how can you be a professor of monetary economics when you do not know what is the role of Reserve Bank of India in this country? Where did you do your PhD? Sir, Princeton. Throw it off. Throw it out of the window. And you know very well that I am very sharp. I am very nasty if it comes to that. So that particular thing is, they are saying one thing and they are doing totally another.
Yes. There is another general question asked by Professor Jaisimha, principal of Bellary Law College, Belgaum. Whether the NEP 2020 affects the autonomy of the institutions, higher education institutions specifically.
Jeevan Kumar?
Yeah.
Yes, okay. That's a good question, which I think somehow none of us covered. Let me repeat the question. Will the new economic policy affect the autonomy of educational institutions? Now, if you read the document very carefully, here and there they do talk of autonomy, but they say they will not interfere in the autonomy of educational institutions. They're going to lay down the ground rules. They're going to lay down the framework. They're going to tell institutions what exactly they're supposed to be doing. And then they will allow them to become autonomous. Now, if you can understand this logic, and if you want to believe it, well, it's up to you. The whole framework is so minutely organized, minutely detailed. What should be taught, the subjects, the kind of teaching that should be done, everything is very clearly laid down, right down to research also, who's to fund, how it should be funded, so on and so forth. But when it comes to autonomy, they say the three categories of HEIs will be given full autonomy to do whatever they would like to do. In fact, you can proceed from a system of graded autonomy and finally become fully autonomous, but then you should be able to fall in line with what the NEP and what the Czar sitting in New Delhi really wish you to do. That understanding of autonomy is very difficult for us to accept, because if they're putting everything down and saying this is how you should do it, and the regulatory and other institutions are going to follow very carefully what you're doing, and if they're not happy, if they can penalize you or if they can get upset with you and take it out in other ways, I don't think the kind of autonomy that they're speaking about in one hand can really be given to the higher education institutions. What they're giving in one hand, I think they're taking back from the other hand. So I still call the whole thing top-down. I refer to what Dr. Deshpande said at the very beginning. In a federal setup, especially when education is in a concurrent list, what business does the MHRD ministry, even if they're going to rename now as Ministry of Education, what business do they have to lay down all those ground rules and this is exactly how things should be done? There itself, at one stroke, autonomy is defeated. So right down the line, when look at it very carefully, I find that autonomy is just not available. They want to put us all into straitjackets. They want to put institutional straitjackets. And I think by doing this, they'll be able to produce holistic individuals, ensure that they'll be employable, ensure that they will be appreciated, ensure that this, that, and so on. I don't think this is happening. My understanding of autonomy is quite different from the NEP's understanding of autonomy. Of course, I'm not sure whether everybody would share this perception, but this is how I'm looking at it.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your response. Since it has been more than 3 hours, we are here on this virtual platform. But however, I would like to take one last question, and it is specifically addressed to Professor Haseen Taj, madam. Madam, one of the participants asked that, is it proper to start education from third year at the early age of three? Because one of the best education systems in the world, Finland, starts education at the age of seven. So is it right to start education at the age of three is a question of the participant.
I agree with you. Here, the education that we are to see, it is not that the child should be loaded with any books, or the child should be given of learning, reading, writing, or maybe doing any numericals, or maybe doing any type of a tedious job. It has to be just a play-based, it has to be fun-based. The child should be sensitized within the environment. The child should know the nature. The child should learn from the nature, that the colors, that the shapes. The child should become sensitive. That means by being with a peer group, the child would be mentally ready to take up when he just enters the formal education. It is only that type of education that we are perceiving. I am against the type of education that is being given in most of the kindergartens, that is in LKG and UKG, where even the parents are expecting every child, as soon as he enters the school, that he should learn like 20 poems, or he should recite so many poems, learn so many tables, and just also rote memorization of so many numbers, and do all sorts of work, start writing the alphabet. No, I am against that as an educationist. The child should have spent the childhood maybe in the natural environment and in the nature, through the fun and through the play. He learned to know the colors. He learned to know, like, with the nature. He learned the etiquette. He learns the behavior. He learns to be cooperative. He learns to be courteous. So that is what the type of education we are asking the child to be. from 3 to 6, and it is that type of education, not a formal type of education to be imposed. And even in the first and second standard also, it has to be just merely an activity based, where the child would be just will be introduced to the foundational skills of maybe the numeracy or something. And one thing I would like to tell you, whenever there is a learning of language, I don't know how can a NEP, such a document which would be widely circulated not only in the world and people from all over the globe will be reading it, any language which is learned, that is in the order of hearing, speaking, then reading and writing. So any time that a mother tongue that a child learns, the mother and father, as soon as a child, maybe when he is a few months old, the child keeps hearing to the voices of the parents, maybe the siblings, maybe the extended family, then he picks up the words, he starts speaking, then comes the reading and the writing. And throughout the document that I could see, whenever there is a multilingualism, whenever there is a language, they have said that the child should learn reading, writing. So that is not the order of teaching the language. Actually, it has to be reversed. It has to start with hearing, speaking, then reading, writing. And that is missing in the national education policy. So that is not the learning of a language. And actually, the child between 3 to 6 are only preparing the child mentally for a formal education. And the child at any cost should not be given any type of reading, writing, or any numeracy before 6. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for your response. I hope participant received the answer for the question. With this, we'll come to the end of the question answer session. Now I request our colleague, Dr. Chaitra Prasad, sir, to do the formal vote of thanks.
Yeah. Good afternoon once again. I'm more blessed than anyone in this occasion because I got the chance to thank each and every visionaries who spread their knowledge for this kind of situation. Because since after 30 decades, we are moving towards a new change or a new kind of academic scenario, which is everyone must understand what are the best and the bitter part of that. So through this webinar, I believe that every speakers, visionaries who made an attempt and gave great inputs for all of us to how to accept or if we want to go with that with a critical appreciation, that also we learned. So with this, I thank honorable dignitaries and the most valued panelists. Because it's my privilege to propose vote of thanks. I thank on behalf of KLE Society's Law College. It's my gratitude. It's my duty to express our gratitude to honorable speakers, Professor Deshpande sir and Professor Jeevan Kumar sir, Professor Haseem Taj madam and Professor Jagdish sir for your great and visionary kind of inputs for making this NEPS better, because I hope this we will going to make to reach the even the administrative peoples also. So in that regard, yes, it is a very wonderful, great experience for all of us, all the participants and all. So we thank behalf of all of our KLE societies to all the resource persons. Thank you. And with a great warm thanks to our Cardinal Jal, the professor and principal of our college, Professor Mallikarjuneya, because he is the great strength for us to host these kinds of webinars, which is very helpful, not only for the students, it is necessary for each and everyone. So thank you very much, sir, for your committed and work, how you know how to execute the things very well. So thank you very much. And also being every small things, the programs to become a successful, we need every claps to be come together. So in that regard, our faculty members, especially our IQSC coordinator, a dynamic person who takes everyone in a progressive manner. So Dr. Manoj Kumar, sir, I thank you. And also I thank our technical head for this webinar, that is our colleague Tanmay sir. And also I thank especially a special thanks to each and every participants, who includes the scholars and the teachers and the students, the every participants and the stakeholders of this educational field. So I hope that this gave you a wonderful experience to take you to your field of education, as well as your, to improve your personality, to understand NEP, what exactly NEP is meant for. So with this, I again thanks to each and everyone, and we look forward to some in future in the course of time also. Thank you, and over to Manoj Kumar sir.
Thank you, Chaitra Prasad sir. With this, we come to the end of the program. I appeal all the participants to take part in all the future academic activities hosted by KLE Law College offline as well as online. Again, on 14th of this month, we are coming out with a webinar on environmental law. Do participate in that as well. With this, with the permission of the resource persons and principal sir, we will end the meeting. Thank you. Thank you, Manoj.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, panelists. We look forward to your support and assistance. Thank you.
Tanmay sir, and could you please tell about the feedback forms and other things regarding to the participants?
Yes, sir. Feedback form link will be sent to the registered email IDs. And after filling the form, they will be getting an auto-generated certificate from the Google Forms itself. I will be shooting that right away. Thank you, sir.
Thank you once again to all.
Yes. We could end the
meeting. Sir, shall I end?
Yes.
Yes, thank you, sir. Thank you.